بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد
أبو بصير was one of the companions living in Mecca who did not make hijrah in the time of Hudaybiyah. Okay? He did not make hijrah in the time of Hudaybiyah. And the Hudaybiyah treaty was a very unique treaty. Okay? The treaty said, which the Prophet ﷺ signed and agreed to, he said that the Muslims will not make the Umrah in that year, they will go the next year. And there will be 10 years ceasefire between the Muslims of Medina and the tribes surrounding them, and the Quraysh and all the tribes that are allied with them, part of the alliance. And he said that as a condition, that any Muslims who want to leave after the treaty from Mecca to go to Medina, they will not be allowed to go. They'll be sent back to Mecca. Okay? But anybody who wants to leave Medina and join the Quraysh and go to Mecca, they'll be allowed to go. Okay? So obviously, this is why many of the Sahaba were upset with the Hudaybiyah. They felt that they were being oppressed. That it was was not in the favor of the Muslims. This is what they felt. Okay? And they did not want to have this type of conditions. Because it seemed to be all one-sided. Anyone Muslim wants to leave Islam or leave Medina and go to Mecca, they can desert Islam and go to Mecca. But anybody wants to leave the shirk and go to the Muslims and join the Muslims in Darul Islam in Mecca, in Medina, they're not allowed to go to Medina. This was the treaty. Okay, so it was stacked in the favor of Quraysh. Okay. Now, what happened was, after this treaty, Abu Basir, who was living in Mecca, he escaped from Mecca and he went to Medina. And this is obviously the treaty said that he's not allowed to go to Medina, he should be sent back. So when he went to Medina and he said to the Prophet ﷺ that even he's been beaten, he's been attacked as well by the Quraysh, that they've been harming him because of Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ said, I cannot accept him because of the treaty. He must fulfill his condition of the treaty. And when two men from the Quraysh came to collect Abu Basir, Rasulullah ﷺ, he did not prevent them from taking Abu Basir. Because that was the treaty, that Abu Basir, the Muslims who come from Mecca, they will not find refuge in Medina. So, allowed them to go. Okay, allowed them to take Abu Basir. So the argument from this, that people they will say, they argue that therefore, it's allowed for me to hand my Muslim brother to the police. It's allowed for the Pakistani government to hand over Sheikh Khalid Sheikh Mohammed or Abu Layth or all of those Mujahideen to go to Guantanamo Bay. What's the big deal? They said, what's the problem? We have treaties with America. Pakistan has a treaty with America. Saudi Arabia has a treaty with America. So why shouldn't they talk to the Mujahideen on behalf of America? Why shouldn't they hand them over to the British? Why shouldn't they extradite them whenever they want? Why not? So their argument is that look, we have treated the way Rasulullah had treated. Okay? You can't call it tawalli, you can't call it alliance. You can't say that if somebody joins the armies of the kuffar and helps them to arrest Muslims and helps them to take them to the prisons and helps them to keep them in Belmarsh, that is alliance or that is kufr. Because they say Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he allowed the Quraysh to take away Abu Basir. He did not protect him. He did not give him refuge. Okay, because of the treaty, and he fulfilled the conditions. Okay, this is the argument. There's a couple of things about this. Okay, the first thing we need to understand is this incident is well known. Ibn Hazm al-Dahiri, he mentioned about it. That this action, it was from al-amal al-khasa, okay, from the specific action that was specific to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Only permitted for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to have this condition in this treaty. Like the permission for him to have more than four wives is only for Rasulullah. And the reason for that is because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had revelation specifically about this treaty and about those Muslims, that Allah will find them a way out. That Allah will give them a route away, out of their own situation. Okay, so this condition will not be a problem. It'll be mentioned. Ibn Hazm, he said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not send any of the Muslims to the Kufar in this period, except that he knew that he will be saved. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never spoke from his desires, only his revelation. He said, this matter, nobody can know about it after the Prophet. And so he's not allowed for any Muslim to have this condition, okay, to fulfill this type of condition, because that is only from ilm al-ghayb, that was only revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this matter about, you know, whether or not somebody can find a way out or not, this is only something, a matter of ghayb. Only Allah can inform the Prophet about it. A prophet about it. So for somebody who is not a prophet, they cannot put this type of condition down. Because every other indication would be that we cannot help, we cannot give any Muslim in this situation. And look to what happened. Okay.
Was that the reference for that?
For Ibn Hazm's... This is the same statement of Ibn Hazm al-Dahir, he's one of the scholars. I believe is in his Asbab al-Nusul. He has a book about Asbab al-Nusul of the Ayat.
Okay, yes. And there's also the statement of Umar ibn Tabar, who complained, and yeah, when he saw the soul come from.
So the other, I'll give you this hadith now, inshallah. The hadith of Umar al-Khattab in Sahih Muslim. Okay, that when this happened, Umar said, how can we send him back? Okay. How can we send him back? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that whoever that left us to go back to them, Allah will make him distant from us. I mean, whoever left, deserted the Muslims to go to the Quraysh, Allah will make him distant from us. But whoever comes to us from them, Allah will find him a way out for them. Allah will find a way out for them. Okay, this hadith is Sahih Muslim. So see, this is the indication that Rasulullah had knowledge of the ghayb, of the future, of what will happen in this incident in particular, which is why he was able to put this condition, fulfill this condition, because he had this guarantee from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why when Umar questioned him, he could explain what the situation was. But nobody else can give this information. Nobody can have access to this ghayb except for him, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's been mentioned as well by other scholars as well. Okay, by Ibn al-Arabi, okay, the one from Ahl Sunnah. Okay, Ibn al-Arabi is an imam from Ahl Sunnah. Bin Arabi was a kafir Sufi, so be careful of the two. Ibn al-Arabi is the one who was Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah. He said that this condition is not permissible to be fulfilled by anybody after the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second thing is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not have tawalli with them. He did not ally with them. He did not help them to arrest. He did not help them to find Muslim to take him away or to oppress him. The only thing that he could not do was not to give Abu Basir refuge. He could not give him refuge. But he did not find a way to give Abu Basir to the Quraysh. The Quraysh came looking for Abu Basir. And they took him away. And then look what happened after they went away with him. Because Abu Basir never reached Mecca again after that. What happened after? Look to the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala found a way out for Abu Basir and for the Muslim. That was even better than for him to stay in Medina. When Abu Basir was going back with the two men from Quraysh, an incident happened where they stopped to rest. And Abu Basir, he was talking with his captors. And he saw the sword of one of the men. And he started to praise him. And he said, look, what an amazing sword. This is excellent sword. And he said, can I look at it? Okay, and also the man very proud, said, look, I've got, you know, somebody's talk about my car, so it's a good car. I said, yeah, please, look, you know, have a look at my car, it's fantastic. You see what I'm driving? You see the way I'm what kind of big man I am? So I wanted to show him his sword. He said, yeah, look at my sword. He took the sword and he killed the two men. And he went back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, okay, with the money as well. And when he went to Rasulullah, Rasulullah said, I can't accept your money because I have treaty with them. Okay? What did he do? Did he arrest him and call the Quraysh and say, look, come again, I've got him, I'll call him for you? No. Because that would be the alliance. When he saw that, he said, look, you know, Allah found a way out for you that basically that Rasulullah held to his covenant and Abu Basir escaped. And what Rasulullah said, he even encouraged him, motivated him. This is one of the proofs as well, that who said to you, just because you have covenant security, that you're not allowed to have psychological warfare against the enemy. You're not allowed to have motivating the believers to jihad. When he said to Abu Basir, he said, that verily you are a man of war, if you only had with you some men. Even though Rasulullah could not give him any men, because he has covenant with the Quraysh. But he then said to him, MashaAllah, he said, look, you are a man of war, if only you had some men with you. Encouraging, telling him as well, giving him advice. This is what you need to do. You need to build jama'ah. That's when you're going to be able to have to deal with the Quraysh. So Abu Basir, after that, he went out and he camped in the mountains between Mecca and Medina. And whenever the Quraysh came out with their caravans, he would raid them and attack them and take their own wealth. He continued to do this. And obviously, the way he gave advice to have with him men, other men from Mecca started to escape. And they joined Abu Basir. And Abu Jandal and others start to become jama'ah, start to have army, start to raid all the caravan of Quraysh. Until the Quraysh became so upset. Because look, they cannot blame Rasulullah. Rasulullah held to his covenant. He did not accept Abu Basir in Medina. Okay? Rather, he fulfilled the covenant and Abu Basir was no longer part of it, of either Mecca or Medina. So whatever he does raid is nothing to do with Rasulullah. So they sent a letter to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, take this man in your covenant. Let him come to Medina. We release him. And by the time Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he sent the good news to Abu Basir that he can enter Medina, before the message reached him, he passed away. Okay, so he died before he could then go back to Medina. Okay.